Lloyd Gaines moved to St. Louis in 1926 when he was 14 years old. The youngest son of Carrie Gaines, Gaines had four other siblings. Gaines is pictured here with his older brother, Larry. The family was from Oxford, Mississippi, but soon settled in this two-story house in St. Louis. As a student, Lloyd was above average. He graduated from Vashon High School in 1931, completing his high school coursework in just 3 years. He was first in a graduating class of 50 students and received the Alumni Award at graduation. A short time later, he attended Lincoln University in Jefferson City. After obtaining a degree in education from Lincoln, Gaines applied for admission to the University of Missouri Law School. As expected, his application was turned down. Cindy Bassett is a law librarian at MU Law School. She helped put together the Lloyd Gaines digital collection.
He applied to the university and he was not accepted based on his race alone. And at that point in time, the state had an official policy that African Americans who wanted graduate education in Missouri were basically funded to go out of state. And a lot of them went to Kansas to do their graduate degrees. And that's how they got around having to admit students here. And Lloyd Gaines really wanted to go to law school in Missouri. He felt like it would be a really important step in terms of establishing a law practice in Missouri. And so he and the NAACP filed suit in Boone County, which they lost. They appealed to the Missouri Supreme Court, which they lost. And they appealed to the United States Supreme Court, which decided to hear the case, and they won.
Article 11, Section 3 of Missouri's state constitution provided that African Americans would be provided separate schools. But the only law school in Missouri at the time was the University of Missouri. With the help of the NAACP, Gaines filed a petition for writ of mandamus on January 24, 1936. The university soon filed its opposition. The Boone County Court denied the writ, but the NAACP pressed on. They appealed to the Missouri State Supreme Court, but on December 9, 1937, the State Supreme Court upheld the Boone County Court decision, refusing to admit Gaines to the law school. The NAACP took the Gaines case all the way to the United States Supreme Court. Justice Hugo Black, a former KKK member, sat on the court. On Gaines' side were his original lawyers, Sidney Redmond and Charles Hamilton Houston, but now they were aided by future Supreme Court Justice, Mr. Thurgood Marshall. While the case was pending in the courts, Lloyd Gaines entered the University of Michigan. In 1937, he received a master's degree in economics from the university before the U.S. Supreme Court decision in Gaines was handed down. On December 12, 1938, the Supreme Court rendered a 5-2 decision that was both a victory and a loss for Gaines. The verdict stated that Missouri must admit Gaines to the law school or provide an equal law school facility for African Americans within the state. In spite of vigorous protests all over the state, the legislature passed House Bill No. 195, known as the Taylor Bill. It gave Lincoln University the authority to establish whatever graduate and professional schools necessary to make Lincoln equal to the University of Missouri. Lincoln University Law School was established in 1939. Its campus was in St. Louis rather than Jefferson City, where the school's main campus sat. On September 21, 1939, Lincoln University Law School opened with 30 students, most of them from the St. Louis area. Lloyd Gaines, however, was not among them. Space had been rented in the Poro Building in St. Louis. A faculty of 4 were recruited. The school's new dean came from Howard University. The law library had 10,000 volumes by the first day of classes. Meanwhile, the NAACP was preparing for its next legal step, a hearing before the Boone County Court to determine whether or not Lincoln University Law School was in fact equal to MU's law school. The hearing was set for October 7, 1939, in Columbia. In preparation for the hearing, the NAACP's chief counsel, Charles Houston, and Sidney Redmond came to Missouri a week ahead of time to inspect the law school and to take depositions. It was then that the attorneys were struck with a humongous bombshell. Lloyd Gaines, their named plaintiff, was nowhere to be found. Gaines had disappeared. He apparently just dropped from sight. No one had any idea what to do next. Nedra Jackson is also one of MU's law librarians. She's worked at the university for nearly 30 years. She weighs in on Lloyd Gaines' disappearance here.
And I don't think there's ever going to be an answer. You know, I think all of the information and everything that we have points to the possible, you know, disappearance as being something that resulted in physical harm or injury to him. I think the information and the insights that we have from the family seem to indicate that this is not a person that would have just left and not ever communicated with any other family members for years. So I think, you know, it's probably right to assume that he is deceased. But I don't know that we'll ever be able to prove that, or anyone will ever be able to come up, unless there's some information that comes to light in some future time frame that actually shows what actually happened to him. But I think it's probably safe to presume that he died and that somebody, from some physical injury, happened to him that disallowed him to be able to come to the law school or to stay connected with his family.
Even though his last letter to his mother said, "Don't worry about me if you don't see me," I took that as being a very normal mode of communication, that things just move slowly and that they wouldn't be hearing from him quickly. I think he was harmed. I don't have any proof for that, but I just don't see him leaving something so important undone.
The circumstances surrounding Lloyd Gaines' mysterious disappearance will likely remain a mystery forever. But here's what we know today about Lloyd's strange disappearance. Lloyd Gaines left St. Louis to speak at an NAACP rally in Kansas City. After the rally, he took a train to Chicago. Gaines went to Chicago looking for work. He stayed with his fraternity brothers for a few days while he was there. On the night he disappeared, he told the door attendant at the fraternity house he was going out to buy stamps. After that night, Lloyd Gaines was never seen again. With no named plaintiff in the case, the NAACP could take the case no further. New plaintiffs were difficult to find, and in January of 1940, the case was finally dismissed by the Boone County Court. Lincoln Law School was the only tangible result of the case, but it was closed in 1943 for lack of students. It had only been in operation for 4 years. In a letter he wrote to his mother in early March, Gaines ended the letter by saying, "Should I forget to write for a time, don't worry about it. I can look after myself okay." In the same letter, he expresses frustration about finding work, possibly implying that his association with the case was hindering his employment prospects. He goes on to say, "Sometimes I wish I was just an ordinary man, one whose name no one ever recognized." That was the last time anyone ever heard from Lloyd Gaines. Even though Lloyd Gaines never got the chance to attend the University of Missouri, he paved the way for others who would follow in his footsteps, beginning with Harold Holliday Jr., the first African American to graduate from the law school in 1968. Next was Linwood Evans, who graduated in 1969, and Mike Middleton in 1971. Mr. Middleton is now MU's current deputy chancellor.
Well, the atmosphere of the law school when I came was, I guess lonely is the word. I mean, when I came, Jimmy Rollins was there, Doc Holliday and Linwood Evans were there at the time. But they were upperclassmen. I was a freshman. I was the only African American in the first year class. And I just recall being pretty much ignored. Faculty, I think, just took the position that they would leave me alone until I proved myself. They didn't want to embarrass me in class. I think that was the motivation.
Also among the first African-American students were James Jimmy Rollins. Rollins would have graduated in 1969, but was dismissed from the university his second year after being charged with a strange and peculiar drug violation. The university dismissed Rollins before he was actually convicted by the courts, but today, Mr. Rollins holds no grudges.
No, I've never really had any animosity toward the University of Missouri or the law school. I just never had it. It's kind of the way life is, you know. Things happen and you deal with it and you move on, you know. I've just never really
But
now,
as far as
the university, I got an excellent education. Law, I mean, undergrad, everything. So I have no regrets about it at all. I enjoyed every minute of it. Even discrimination that was going on against us, it opened my eyes to a lot of things, because I came out of St. Louis and we didn't, I'd never really been exposed to discrimination and prejudices and that much. We had it, but we lived in our own community, and by doing that, we didn't have to deal with that. And to get up there and have to deal with all of that, I think it opened my eyes to a lot of things. The legacy is that it opened up the law school, it opened up the university, and it led to Brown versus Board of Education eventually. And so there is a legacy that we all feel that it was necessary for these things to take place. And so I respect the fact that someone did carry it on and allowed us to move on at the level that we're working at now.
And I think that the legacy of Lloyd Gaines is that he participated in being a stepping stone in change. It didn't change everything, it didn't change it right away, but the actions that he took made a really positive impact. So one person can make a difference.
I think that one thing that students, when you look at this collection, or any researcher that looks at this collection, can gain some insights that, you know, when you have a dream, that you need to go out and pursue it. That we each all have an opportunity, we all walk different paths, but we should go out and try to accomplish our goals and dreams. And I think that's something you can take from him, is some perseverance, some diligence. There are going to be challenges, but you never give up. Many of us, we wouldn't have had that opportunity to be able to have that today, to be able to have a law degree, or to be able to have a master's or PhDs, you know. And so I think, you know, we need to respect that and understand that and applaud that. But then we also need to have, and within ourselves, recognize that we make a difference, that we impact someone else's life, and that continuing to be successful in whatever we do, you know, in the long run is going to impact others' lives. And so, you know, do what you can, keep dreaming, keep encouraging others to dream and to achieve their goals.
Well, Lloyd Gaines' legacy really has afforded me the opportunity to be here at the University of Missouri School of Law. You know, his vision, you know, his goal, his aspirations of becoming a law student here at Mizzou is what has given me the opportunity, and maybe he was not afforded the fruits of his labor, but it has opened the doors and allowed minority students like myself to be admitted into the School of Law here in Columbia, Missouri. Being a minority student from, you know, the East Coast and also a non-traditional student, I just think that, you know, the things that Lloyd Gaines has done or had done in the past, his efforts, you know, I am actually the fruits of that labor.
Well, for me, Lloyd Gaines's legacy is another outward representation of our people's resilience and ability to persevere. My favorite part of his story is knowing that he very well could have accepted the scholarship to attend the neighboring school that actually accepted African Americans. Instead, he stood to his guns and he stood by his beliefs and stood firm in what he believed in, and He just persevered until he really, really acquired his goal. And although his aspirations never came to a physical fruition, he is, just the story of his resilience really spoke to me.
What strikes me about the Lloyd Gaines legacy is that it really reminds me that there are people who essentially give their lives to make things better for the generations that follow. And, you know, I'm not talking about Lloyd literally giving his life. I mean, we don't really know what happened to Lloyd Gaines. So that's the legacy. He was an essential part of that whole strategy to undo segregation in higher education. But in taking that role, he gave up on what his life plan had been, and that's a significant sacrifice.
The legacy for me is just
basically remembering. That's one of the reasons why I wanted to do this video, is because I wanted to let everyone know what a compelling story this was. I was intrigued by it the more I researched it. And I think paying homage to those who sacrificed, to those who came before us, is what we need to stay motivated, and it's what sort of carries us forward. I'm so proud of this video, and I hope that I did justice to Lloyd. I hope that I did justice to, you know, all the people that have come before me and who sort of, I guess, paved the way. I'm really proud of it. Really proud of it.